we're going to talk about Julia for data analysis.
So, a bit of an impossible case talking about Julia and Python models, but I'll try and talk about how Julia works with Python. I don't actually have any data from her to talk about, so he's a nice little flight of data, which I just want to see the probabilities depending on success, parole success for business. It's probably parole during the time of day, so this is a nice little off for lunch. So hopefully that doesn't talk about it. So, what is Julia? It's a dynamic, high-performance language, originally designed for computing, but it's starting to become much more broad. The syntax, I guess, is very heavily influenced by Python, the smattering of Python, and a few other things. So here's a nice example of here. It's, as you can see, the main sort of syntactic differences from Python, which is surprisingly contentious for computer reading hacking. Basically, rather than typically white space using an end block and it's one base to basic, but if you can look at that, which is actually to another degree, then it's, you'll pick it up very quickly in the Python language. So, why Julia? Why would you want to use it? Fundamentally, if you want to write fast, efficient code in one language, so you don't want to write, have to write something in Python and then dump it into C or Fortran, etc. So avoid what we term the two-name problem. The other really nice thing about it is it makes it very easy to sort of peek under the hood and see what is actually going on in each implementation, why it's slow, how you can make it faster, etc. For example, most of Julia itself is written in Julia. Surprised me, it's more bit of it than actually written anywhere else. And at each stage of computation, you can step through it and go, right, here's what it's doing as it gets converted from the code I wrote to actual machine code. Also, it's free, it feels good, and it's surprisingly fun. And finally, it plays very nicely with sort of existing tool chains. And that's certainly improving as we go. So, the sort of single most important things to know about Julia, firstly the types, so roughly analogous to Python classes, but somewhat different in the sense of, well, firstly every object has a type, so the type of one is, if that's a symbol, the type of a function, it's not a function, and the type of a type is a data type. You can declare new types just with a type called type keyword, and then you can use various objects of those types. Firstly, the one really important thing to say is that unlike many dynamic languages, types in Julia, user-defined types are just as fast as built-in types. There's no reason that they're not like set class citizens, they have to then go hacking to get to make faster because use all these long instructions. You can just use the user-defined types straight up. The other very important thing to know about Julia, where it diverges significantly from other object-oriented languages, is that Julia functions don't belong. Julia functions are generic; they don't belong to a type. So we define a function here. So you can call sys-defined a function. It does two things. If it's the argument is a floating point number, it prints a float. It's something else. So this is a different, slightly different syntax. It's sort of a nice one-line syntax for writing functions, which becomes very useful if you write a long one like this. And this topical is what's called the type certification. Specifies the types that is acceptable to each input. And so if we call it a floating point number, we get the point to a float, and it's an integer. And so as I mentioned, unlike traditional object-oriented languages, functions don't belong to a particular type. So what that means is that also we have what's called multiple dispatch, and a dispatch, how a function function, how method, a particular method, so each one of these is a method inside the function. Which method is chosen is determined by all the arguments of the function, not just the first one. So it's not, which makes it very, to make it much more powerful to write to make that sort of objects. So, for example, here we have a expression, we can add some more methods, so each of these takes two arguments. So the first one takes a float 64 integer. The second one takes any real numbers. The last one is a generic method that takes any object whatsoever. So if we, each one of those then dispatches to the correct method as we hope, clearly based on the items. For example, then if you want to show how that particular object is printed, we so as object defined earlier, this is handled by the show function. And show is a generic function, and it's made up of these different methods. We can view all those by typing show. The methods of show. And so as you can see, there's 105 of them. And each so when you call show on a particular object, it looks up to see which one. The other thing you'll notice is that most of these are two methods, two argument methods. And what this means is that most of the show methods taken on what's called minor object as first argument. So this leads those to write to different places. You can write to send it out, you can write to others, files, etc. And there's a generic fallback. See, there's a generic method called the shape single argument, which just prints it to the standard out. So if we want to overwrite show, we first import it, and then we assign a new method for this as object. And then, display it, it just prints using a new method. So that's the rough idea of multiple dispatches. So this becomes very powerful, especially when you start doing much more complicated things. So a really nice example is matrix multiplication. So if you have a matrix multiplication, we have different matrix types. So it really has there's a standard dense matrix, the sparse matrices, there's structure matrices like diagonals and tridiagonals. And each of these can then dispatch onto the correct, so you're multiplying two types of matrices, you can dispatch them onto the fastest matrix multiplication method, and then to pull back to a standard triple four loop that we're doing. Finally, the other really sort of important ingredient that makes it fast is what's just-in-time completion. So basically, every time you call a function, it's just-in-time compiled down to the machine instructions, and then it's going to be executed. So functions are the fundamental unit of which all Julia methods are compiled. And so the first tip, when people first start using Julia, they're playing it slow, and the single fast, easiest way to improve the code is to call it as a function, and you call it so it's much faster. The other one is, the other trick is, somewhat a little bit more involved, but to get the most out of Julia, particularly how it works internally, use a trick called type inference. So when it starts the compilation process, it goes through and tries to figure out what actually the type of each variable is in your program or function. And so to do that efficiently, you need to sort of get a little bit of writing what's called type table code so that as the program executes, the type of variable doesn't change. And somewhat, you see this for certain things. For example, this is the example why, for example, square root of 1 doesn't promote to a complex type, because otherwise we would be converting, when the part will see a square root of a floating point number, it wouldn't know whether the output result will be a floating point number or complex type. So you need to use this for the complex. And this pops up in a few other cases. Another one is that integer arithmetic by default doesn't. Unlike Python, it doesn't promote to the integers after the integers, because otherwise you can go up and have a fast integer arithmetic. So for that reason, you can get integer arithmetic is the same as we can see, because there's no numbers branching to see if it's actually, excellent going out and size the type, and you can promote to the speed of the one. The other neat trick, which I won't touch on too much, is metaprogramming. And this is something really powerful when it comes to this background. the idea is basically that you can actually write Julia code, so Julia can actually manipulate Julia expressions with Julia itself. So if you put, you can sort of quote an expression using this column stats, then puts it in a string that gives you expression objects, which we can then. And the other useful thing is their macros, which essentially transform expressions, which operate on expressions that transform and then execute. So these are prefixed with that. So if you look at Python Decoder, obviously very similar to Python Decoder, but it's much more powerful than how they work, because you can actually manipulate the code inside. A very simple one is the time macro, which tells you exactly how long it takes to run. This is a good example of the just in time relation, because you can see that's 20th of a second, and the next time you run it, the time is much slower, much bigger, because now the function I defined earlier has been just in time compiled. You can actually see what that expands, what the actual code is doing. You can expand the macro code. As you can see, there's the, so essentially it's calculated the time, current time, computes the expression, and then computes the difference in time, prints it, and returns to the value which the computer about. These are quite powerful because, as I said earlier, you can sort of view all these states of the compilation process. So that function we found earlier, this is the first stage, this is the type inference process. As you can see, it's a bit messy, but you can see what happened. So the tags each expression of what it thinks the type will be. And then step down to what's called the LVM intermediate representation, which is essentially the level that the LVM backend manipulates expressions and does all the optimizations on that. And then finally, you actually go all the way down to what is the assembly that is generated by that resulting expression. And macros are really quite powerful. They give you all sorts of tricks which you would otherwise be quite which never which make it this rules very tricky. So a very own example is this is what's probably called a package called junk, which essentially is a mathematical optimization package, so domain specific language optimization programs. So you specify your optimization problem in this language, and you can edit it. Lets you call all sorts of different optimization packages like Rogi, C, Lex, etc. Automatically without having to change your program to change the different backend optimizers. And finally, which is the rest of my talk we'll talk about, are the packages. So Julia has a very extensive and growing sort of third-party packaging system, obviously. And very easy to add packages, which is why I package my app in Julia. And active packages, in case you're a search involved, are typically suffixed with a .jl extension, which makes them very easy to search for, which is actually the desired to search for something .jl, usually the first Google hit. So the next one. So the entire top of my talk is talking about the Julia data. So I'm going to go over some of the packages that we have for Julia. Using Julia's a very simple one is what's called a distribution package. So, as the name suggests, it essentially provides a lot of different probability distributions. And it's a very elegant object-based structure. So, each class of distributions is a type. So, if you make a gamma or gamma distribution, you can just construct a gamma object. Various, and then all the various methods then can be applied directly to these objects. So, you can need means, variances, and then CVS, etc., and then all random numbers, from those distributions. There's also some very basic simple estimation functionality, so if you want to fit then result in those random numbers to a given distribution, you can do that, or you might see the power of a normal distribution that would fit, etc., do that something. So you can pass types for these ones as well. And then, see, one of the nice things about this under the hood, these distributions are defined as a mutable type, which lets you do all sorts of optimization done with the possible model. So, for example, it allows, because it knows the unit is a mutable type, it knows it can be represented exactly by those two fields, those two parameters, you can do papers, sort of distribution stack. And so essentially there's no overhead to creating and destroying these objects. I'm writing this bit, creating objects in the class that has to then allocate the objects and destroy the bit and die, etc. And there's also lots of efficient methods for multi-arrow distribution. So multi-arrow particularly some normal distributions where group equality factors and also exploit known instructions. So if we want to construct a multi-arrow normal with a diagonal covariance, you can see this creates what's known as a zero mean So if it has a zero mean, it also has a diagonal covariance. So you can exploit that structure to do computations much faster than it would if it was a full dense covariance structure.
So it's very simple. Here we pass an X and a Y as a
specified as X and Y vectors. And it gives you an SVG output. But also, it's very nice, it's an interactive SVG output, so you can zoom in and out and drag things around. So this is just a simple SVG file with a JavaScript tagged onto it. So if you save this, if I save this out in a file, everyone can, you'll still get the same interactive features. So it's very nice and portable, and very powerful scheme. It also plays very nicely with the data frame, so if I have that Iris data set before, we get some very nice color pictures. And of course, we can apply this. Geometry, so here you specify the coordinates, so in sort of your graphics instruction, you specify the coordinates by Q and A. So the first coordinate is C width, Y is C length, and then your color, which is the coordinates, is the specified species. You can also change that, for example, to level width, and then you get a nice gradient type color there as well. The geometry, it's also different from the other. So it's all these different facets. The first one is the coordinates. The other one is these geometries. So you pass these extra arguments. So simple one, you pass a line, plot, pass geoms on. So these geom objects as a line. It also supports various sort of simple statistical functionality, such as histogram and density. And also supports lots of other things, nice things like themes, scale, so all scales, etc. And units, your axes, which are very nice. And so the next package, so GLM provides a linear and generalized linear model framework. It uses sort of similar formula syntax to R frameworks in Canada before. So this tilde sort of does a little bit of macro trickery in background. So let's see, so it quotes this sort of expression very similar formula syntax. It's slightly different because of how the operator process changes from R. But we can do fit any model. So rather than plotting contrary, we call the object type. And that would fit our sort of simple linear model to the data. And then of course we can then use that model to predict new or to get the fitted values by predicts. So we'll sign up to new columnize and get the results predicted plus the observed. Along nice axis there. So that gives you sort of an idea of the difference in the prediction value. And finally, one other very nice package is purely using syntax models. So the current workforce one is this LME 4 package R. But its author actually has recently moved to writing this code in Julia, and the result is this mixed models package. So for those who've got a nice Christmas sized data set, so this is, I believe this is data, student evaluation data. So it's 73,000 rows, and we can fit. So it supports this very similar syntax to R. We specify the random effects via this bar syntax. And it should take a few seconds. You can fit quite very nice and very large, actually complicated models in this. So it took 7 seconds to fit what is actually a reasonably complicated model. It's a fit syntax models, you know how. And that took 7 seconds of time, that is compiling, we run again, and it's much quicker. So other sort of statistics and data packages that you interest, there's lots of hypothesis testings, hypothesis tests, confidence estimators, sort of inline regressions, so it's suitable in GLM and that supported very well. And it's running. The other thing I want to talk about is how Julia can interact with other languages. So obviously there's a new language we can't compare with sort of the sheer breadth of libraries written in R But it makes it very, very easy to interface with these. The nature of the web makes it very, very easy to interface with these. So, simplest one to C, it has a very, very good interface with all these C libraries. So, here I'm calling the little event in the math library, calling the power function, takes two arguments. Both of which doubles and then return to double the value of the result. So if we do that, simply pulls out the reason. There's also a great other function that can be used to interface with the C function involving creating C compatible function pointers. Things like concept store, concept loader for loading on line bolts straight into it. And then once this, what's really neat is when you compile this by metaprogramming, it's very easy for generating. For writing existing libraries, you don't have to type out all these individually. You just have program and generate all these SQL statements and then use your result of the library. Get a very nice grammar for existing libraries. The Python, you also want to talk about PyPal. So it's not a PyPal, it actually initializes the Python server in the background. You can evaluate sort of strings in Python, so this is just a form of Python, so executing a Python statement. And then evaluating returning to the Julia object. So it returns a Julia Python just to get converted back to a Julia array. There's also a slightly nice interface, it's a PyPy statement. So if you run PyPy macro, creates a Julia module in math, and then imports all the Python, functions in that into this Julia library. So math.sign is the simply is wrap around the PI object, which we can actually call directly. So it's part of the Julia number, it's part of the Python function called evaluates, and it's going to go back to Julia all seamlessly. So there's a match of Julia type, so things like dictionaries and arrays, numbers, and strings, and things can move automatically. If there's not, you get a, it's called a PI object wrapper. One sort of slight aspect of this is that Julia doesn't support overloading the model operator, so you can't call d dot integral. So instead, you have to use sort of a slight level of the get index notation. But that's what works quite well. So we're calling it the same as calling dot integral. NumPy. So NumPy arrays actually use exactly the same memory layout as Julia arrays, so we can actually pass. So you can convert directly between the two. In fact, I think it's Julia arrays you can pass directly to NumPy without any copying. So if you have correct array of Julia, NumPy sees it, it doesn't have to allocate any array. I think the other way back it doesn't allocate any array to the interface of getting these things to work well. But it makes it very easy to call NumPy archive, so it's NumPy code, you can go use NumPy to and you can even pass Julia functions directly to Python functions, which accept members. So, sidebar to optimize, we're passing this Julia runs function, which calls, so this Julia runs function, we pass the sidebar SOU, initial starting one, starting at one, and then does new iterations, and then gives us the number back. So, that's very simple. It's a great example, so I'm going to put in that having a factorial statement, which alternates between the Julia and Python all the way down to a very efficient implementation of factorial, but I have decided to leave that. Finally, PyPlot. You can also load my plotlib by this PyImport, but there's this PyPlot package which is just makes it a little bit nicer. And that's used apps, so if you've got lots of MapPlotlib syntax, you can use it almost directly, translate it directly into Julia. So if you're continuing to software, since every plotting package, there's always this good learning curve of all plotting package, you just want to take your MapPlotlib knowledge and throw it into Julia, it works basically exactly as you expected. So we've got a Julia, two Julia vectors, and then we pass the straight down this plot function, which is called MapPlotlib, and the annuals, and we sort of get a Julia. see it's actually Python object in the background. It's pretty good. And then there's also this PyData package, which essentially is the opposite. And it does the opposite by loading this PyData to the operator, so you can call the two functions between the two. The other one being necessarily needs sometimes come across R. So R call, as you expect, does operate very similar to PyData. So this is an R import macro, which is very similar. So you can load, unfortunately, there's a Julia object called base, so I can't load it as base, but I can load it as R base. And then we can call also the Julia functions. So if you're familiar with the C function, it constructs vectors in R, and so we call it directly, and we get our inconsistent R object back. We don't return Julia objects natively because there's R has a lot of fancy brackets, so like DNA handling does by essential values, so there's all sorts of trickery. So it's easy just to keep them as R objects in this case. They don't match up quite as nicely as the Python does. Updated networks, we get the first the A element or the B element of this hardware. And plugging packages work remarkably well. So we can call this, so I'm just setting the, this just sets the output to the CG. We can call the argx. So this is called the standard R plot function. Unfortunately, if you've ever used R in any detail, one of the some very weird, one of its quirks is what's called non-standard evaluation, which means that unlike any other language, it actually looks at the arguments. What you pass into a function affects it, not just their values. And it's very hard to replicate that Julia because simply Julia's standard evaluation. So usually when you do a plot of a vector in R, you would see they would just put an X here, because that's the name of the variable you put into it. But of course, we can't, Julia doesn't have any way of giving it the name of the vector that you pass to it. So instead of putting all the values, which is somewhat weird. The other problem is that R has lots of syntax which doesn't match up, so it has these square brackets and double square brackets, and then it uses dots in variable names, which obviously conflicts with Julia's syntax. So instead, what there is this very elegant way called non-standard string controls. So you can view these as sort of somewhat similar to Python magics, but not steroids. So what this does is it calls when you prefix a string to some sort of the string variables, it actually is calling a macro, which changes the code to these names. So here, what I'm doing is calling plot. So dollar just does a substitution. So whenever dollar is in valid R syntax, which is basically going in and appears between two variables, two symbols, it will do substitution of the corresponding variable. So the x back here is a vector. So we do this. And it calls essentially passing this R and then converts the syntax. And you can actually view what that, use that. Let's see what that does. So you can see what it's actually doing, it's calling the R, it's substituting the dollar X for the variable, and then it calls the R parser. This makes it very easy to then return an R object back, which in this case is the plot. Well, actually, it returns nothing back, but it just gets a plot out of the plot. And you can actually also substitute, you don't have to use R for the variables, you can put all of your expressions in this dollar syntax. So it can plot between the functions directly, simply by passing in, putting between the dollar. So it makes it very seamless to interoperate between the two. So if we load this, so now we're using the R dataset package, although the iris dataset in Julia. We load the ggplot2 package now, and then call the ggplot2 ggplot function with the iris dataset loaded in, and then use the various variable names. The resulting object gets converted to an R data frame, and then we can then just use that as we read the R data frame. And finally, we can also then fit to the linear model as well. So we have things like LM, pass variables through the pass the other object out through variable, and then we get this vector back. And then you do things like that.
I mean, obviously,
had the advantage of, you know, 15 years of iPhone before this was created, so we can take advantage of that sort of decision. That's all.
Is there any plan to integrate more closely with Pandas? I mean, Pandas has like a very interesting internal representation, so I guess it would be complicated.
I think we can do it. Pandas itself is a lot of how Pandas is done is to avoid the quirks of Python in some sense. So things like the typing, so it's really a lot of to make it fast, it has to read the end of the type system itself in general. And so. Yeah, so we're trying to, sometimes we've got more difficult to work on, but that's it, we want to make it work nicely with these other components. And I think things like that, like I can show how sort of how these go across, but you know, we want to get these things roll so you can take something from your own and get what you made with that. Stop computation and restart it. Yeah. No, there is actually a reason.